Hello, my name is Ryan Boyd. In this series, we're discussing the top use cases for graph databases and showing how they're accomplished with Neo4j. Let's first talk about fraud detection. Fraud detection is important for our customers in the finance industry, but is also important for many other industries, such as retail, insurance, and gaming. Let's talk through one specific type of fraud, first-party fraud. This is when fraudsters take out lines of credit with no intention of repaying them. This costs banks tens of billions of dollars in the United States alone, according to Experian. In first-party fraud, synthetic identities are created by fraud rings through reuse of legitimate contact information, like names and addresses, to apply for credit. Typical investigations of first-party fraud use discrete analysis of data points like the number of accounts and the amount of revolving debt. Fraud rings often know how to avoid detection with these type of algorithms. However, if you look at the pattern of relationships amongst the account holders and contact information, you can find suspected fraud rings in a way that's very difficult to avoid. Here we're looking at graph of account holders, their debt as credit cards and unsecured loans, their bank accounts, and the various bits of contact information used by the account holders. Let's dive in and see how Neo4j is used to find suspected fraud. Here's a GraphGist for bank fraud detection. This GraphGist sets up an example scenario, provides an example data set, and shows you queries to detect first-party fraud within Neo4j. The URL for this GraphGist is in the description of this video if you want to play along at home. Now we've stepped over into the Neo4j browser, and we can see an address node, 94101 zip code, is actually shared by multiple different people, Jane, John, and Matt. This in itself is not that odd, and John and Jane sharing the same phone number is also not that unusual. However, there is another bit of data in this data source, and we can see the bit of data is the Social Security number. And we can see that Matt here has the same SSN as Jane in this data set, and that would be very, very unusual. So this is a potential fraud ring. What's the impact? Well, here we can see that an unsecured loan is held by Jane. And we also see that John has a credit card and Matt has an unsecured loan, all with outstanding balances. So let's hop over and show you the Cypher query language that we can use to return this result that we're seeing visually in the graph. This query will return to us the different potential fraud rings and what contact information they share. So we can see here it's a pretty simple query for those of you who are already familiar with something like SQL. It's easy for you to write this. And we can see here the different fraud rings or potential fraud rings and what piece of contact information they share. In this case, Matt and Jane share the same Social Security number. But what is the risk? What is the risk of lending to that potential fraud ring of Matt and Jane? Well, this query will give us that in a very few lines of Cypher. And we can see here Matt and Jane have a ring size of 2 sharing the same Social Security number, but a financial risk in unsecured loans and credit cards of almost $30,000. So this is quite a concern and possibly indicative of actual fraud that is occurring. We can see how easy it is in this demo to detect possible fraud rings in a graph database and easily write queries that produce the financial risk of those fraud rings.